Hello, Bee here, and welcome back to Environmental Science. For today's freshwater biome field trip, we've traveled all the way to eastern Africa and are on the shores of Lake Victoria. Named after Queen Victoria, this freshwater ecosystem is the largest lake in Africa and the second largest freshwater lake in the world. In fact, Lake Victoria is so large that it can easily be seen on the Earth from space. It is bordered by the countries of Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania. Based on its location and the type of vegetation you see surrounding the lake, what type of environment do you think we'll be exploring? Unlike the desert and tundra that we explored in our last two trips, the abiotic environmental conditions are not particularly harsh here. What then do you think will be the biggest challenge that organisms face? What types of advantages will their adaptations need to provide? Pause the video for a moment and brainstorm some ideas before we head out. We know that all of the spheres are connected within an ecosystem. So let's start by taking a look at the atmosphere here at Lake Victoria. What climate zone do you think the Lake Victoria ecosystem is in? Notice that it's close to the equator. And while it's also close to a large desert, the wet environment around the lake gives this region a tropical climate, meaning that it's warm and humid. And what about the hydrosphere? Remember that the driving force of the hydrosphere is the water cycle. Do you think water will cycle quickly or slowly here, given the environmental conditions present? The lake's vast surface area combined with warm weather means significant evaporation, which contributes to local rainfall and humidity. The water cycle is churning at full speed here. And this means heavy rainstorms can pop up out of nowhere, but you won't need a winter coat since temperatures don't vary much between seasons. Do you think the lake influences this stable climate? Remember, large bodies of water stabilize weather and climate. Lake Victoria's vast water absorbs and stores heat from the sun, preventing the area from getting too hot. When the air cools, the water releases heat, keeping the temperature nearly perfect year-round. I could get used to this. Now that we've explored the atmosphere and hydrosphere, how could we describe the geosphere here around Lake Victoria? Remember that the ecosystem doesn't only include the lake itself, but the land surrounding it as well. Do you think this land is fertile? Why or why not? And how will the fertility of the soil affect the living things that can survive here? The soil around Lake Victoria is exceptionally fertile. The region benefits from volcanic activity that has enriched the soil with essential minerals and nutrients over time. Additionally, the lake itself contributes organic matter and sediments that further enhance soil fertility. Unlike some of the other ecosystems we've visited, it would seem that life has it pretty good here. Do you think it will stay that way, or will this lake dry up and disappear, leaving its inhabitants stranded? The lake's formation will give us a clue. As the African tectonic plate began to split and move apart, the land in the region stretched and created depressions in the Earth's crust. These depressions filled with water, creating Lake Victoria. This means that Lake Victoria is a tectonic lake. And what do we know about the stability of tectonic lakes? They take a long time to form and generally don't change much for millions of years once they do. This is another reason that we see such a large variety of life forms here. they have had plenty of time to perfect their adaptations for this lush habitat. As we've seen, the environmental conditions here are very favorable to life, leading to high biodiversity. But this doesn't necessarily mean the species living here have nothing to worry about. As we explore this lake's inhabitants, ask yourself, what challenges does each species face, and how are they adapted to overcome these challenges? You can fill in the adaptations for each animal in the table in your notes, then we'll compare them at the end. Under the surface of the lake, we would find entire schools of cichlid. These brightly colored fish make up over 500 different species within the lake, with many having a unique mouth shape that is suited for the particular type of food they eat. Some scrape algae off rocks, while others crush snails or catch small fish. Be sure to record their adaptations in your table. Caught resting just at the surface of the lake, we might spot several hippos. These large beasts move back and forth between the water and nearby shorelines throughout the day. The water keeps them cool, but their favorite food source is on land. Hippos typically have no trouble dominating their grazing areas. Why do you think that's the case? What adaptations should you fill in for these animals? Just above the water's surface, we spot a kingfisher. Why do they have such a long, pointed beak? Any ideas? It might have something to do with this behavior. What is it diving into the lake for? Of course, it's hungry. And what about the plant life here? It also thrives in the warm, humid environment, especially the papyrus reeds that form thick mats along the shoreline. Do you know why papyrus tends to dominate the vegetation of this ecosystem? It's all about speed. It grows so quickly, allowing it to reach sunlight and obtain nutrients before other species. But the outcome of this competition is a positive thing. Papyrus is critical for the ecosystem because it provides a habitat and breeding ground for many animal species. And humans use it as well to make paper and even boats. Because it is both strong and lightweight, many cultures in African history have relied on it for boats that traverse the nearby Nile River. Have you finished recording your observed adaptations in your notes? At the beginning of our lesson, I asked you to brainstorm what you thought the biggest challenge would be for species living here in the Lake Victoria ecosystem. Because the environmental or abiotic factors don't pose much of a challenge, you may have guessed that it would be the biotic or other living factors that species would face competition from. Remember, near the beginning of the course, when we first learned about ecological niches, we said that in most cases, a niche or specific role can only be filled by one species. And the species that is able to hold that niche will be the one that outcompetes all the others. So adaptations that make organisms faster, stronger, more efficient, or just more unique are key to surviving here. As we took a tour of the wildlife of Lake Victoria, hopefully you filled out the adaptations you saw. If you missed any, pause the video and add them now. The cichlids have solved the competition problem by diversifying and having many different jaw structures for different feeding strategies. This reduces competition between the different species because they're all looking for different types of food. The hippos have a much more direct strategy. Their large size and intimidating, aggressive nature are enough to scare away most would-be competition. The kingfishers have evolved a long, sharp beak that can snatch a fish out of the water before it sees it coming. And the papyrus reeds use speed to their advantage as well, but their speed is in their growth. They grow tall and develop long roots before other species can catch up. Countless other species in Lake Victoria have developed adaptations that allow them to compete for their niche as well. If not, they wouldn't be here. Even though the climate and environment is forgiving, the competition is not. Survival depends on adaptation, and in Lake Victoria, adaptations are all about out-competing. As we went through the lesson today, we saw how the atmosphere, hydrosphere, and geosphere all influence the biosphere of the Lake Victoria ecosystem. The lake formed from tectonic activity in the geosphere, and the active water cycle of the hydrosphere of the lake has formed a warm, humid atmosphere with a tropical climate. These conditions are ideal for life, but high biodiversity also means high levels of competition between species. Until next time, remember, the biosphere is all around us, so keep diving into this web of life and exploring its wonders. Stay curious, keep asking questions, and I'll see you next time. Hey, hey.